Hello, this is Lars Ubirai from Towncutter.info. You're listening to Scene World Podcast.
Yes. It's the Scene World Podcast. I'm AJ, Jörg is there, and there is a good chance that you're looking at us right now, which is weird because we've never done that before.
Yeah, well, hello everybody. Well, it was just like that. Our guests were so nice. We simply had to record them on video.
They dressed for the occasion, so we felt it was only the right thing to do to give them a video podcast.
Of course. So, and well, so. In a bit, we are talking to Tess Fries and Jeroen Tell, and two big figures who make their own music production together now.
Jeroen Tell was a musician in the C64 scene, did a bunch of game music, made his professional living doing game music, and now they're branching out and turning this into a whole new genre of music that people can download and listen to, and it's kind of cool.
Pixel pop, yeah.
Yes, yeah, they call it pixel pop. First, before we get to that, let us talk. I have a piece of paper here. There's nothing on it. I just make this noise for the audio podcast so people think I'm looking at something, and now that trick has been ruined. But first, let's talk about...
Yeah, totally professional.
Yes, man. Yes. Back in a few podcasts ago, we talked about we talked to the Frag Dolls. Since then, they've all left. The Frag Dolls are empty. We don't know what is going on with whether they will be recruiting new people or what's happening. But our last podcast, we reported that one of them I don't recall who it was. I'm going to say Days.
Days, I believe.
Yeah, had left. And since that time, Siren and Esper, the two that we spoke to, have also left. And then Seltzer left, leaving zero people. So there's nobody in the Frag Dolls. However, that is not altering our plans as far as Extra Life, the charity. I am still on the Frag Dolls team, and so is Jörg now.
Right.
Yeah, because I called him out in the last podcast, and he stepped up and he joined. So he is also a member of the Frag Dolls team. And who are you raising money for?
Well, I'm raising money for International Sick Kids.
Okay.
Because I figured since everything I do is international, and since I'm not living in the USA, I wanted to raise money for something that is internationally. Raising money for all over the world. So this is why I decided for an international treat. So I decided to go for the International Sick Kids thing. That is why. So I thought it would perfectly fit to me, you know. Yes.
Awesome. And I am raising money for the Children's Specialty Hospital in New Jersey. And I've had some donations come in, which is pretty awesome. I don't know who they are. The donations were anonymous, so I can't thank anybody. I would like to thank somebody in the podcast on the air, but I don't know who did it. So, whoever you are, thank you.
You're welcome. Oh no, no, it wasn't.
It wasn't you.
It wasn't me. No. Yeah, but. But since we receive fan email once in a while, you know, we know that people are listening to us, so that's very nice. And we also see the statistics. But hey, let's see. I should share my URL for my Extra Life page.
Yes, yes, you should. Well, mine is www.extra-life.org/participant/AJH, which is pretty easy.
So my Extra Life URL My profile page is extra-life.org/participant/navcom.
Okay. There we go.
Yep. So awesome. You can donate.
Yes.
For me. And yeah, and by the way, nowadays you can even donate for us if you want to give us a dime for our awesome magazine or podcast. You can do that too on steamworld.org/donate, just to mention it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so what happened actually is that Fragdolls left the building, at least the old team, but we are still in touch with some of them, especially Siren, who actually works now for Twitch as a community manager, and that's official, so we can mention it here.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty awesome. But in case we get some news about whether they look for new people or not, or whether they are forming a new team.
Well, the last thing that we heard was that they were actively looking for new people for the cadet program when Esper had left. So that's, as far as we know, they are looking for people. So you should, if you're involved in the community, then you should really, if you want to be part of that, reach out and see what you can do. Until we hear otherwise, I'm just going to keep assuming that they're going to look for people to fill it.
Well, actually, on their Twitter.com page, you know, the Twitter profile, they have this email address, fragdolls@ubisoft.com,
mm-hmm.
where it says, if you want to contact us, write to fragdolls@ubisoft.com. I don't know if that address still works.
Well, write to it, and, well, I'm sure it does. So if you want to be part of it, write to it, and you know, who knows?
Who knows? Well, if it bounced back because the address is no more, then shame on the Fragdolls Twitter page. Anyway, yeah, I hope they reform the team in a way, because it was really awesome.
And we could talk to the new people.
Yep. Well, if you want to be a guest on our show, you're welcome. If you want to welcome us on our show, we would appreciate that too. Yeah. So you see, a lot of things happened in the last 2 months since we released the last podcast issue. Yes. What else happened? Oh, yes. Well, you know, after 12 years, I finally got in touch with Dave Lowe, who was a composer in the 80s and 90s for a lot of arcade games especially, and he made the music conversions for the home consoles and home computer versions, amongst things like, you know, Power Drift, Elite 2, you know, and Star Glider, Hard Driving, and well, he did a Kickstarter for re-releasing it as not Orchestra. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, just like an hour ago, it failed, just with $1,000 short or something in the last second. That was pretty sad. But I talked to his daughter Holly, and she said they will try again. And since it was so close, you know, in the last second, still $1,000 missing.
Mm-hmm.
So it was 99% funded. That's really bitter, but they will try again. So maybe look in the next days for another try from the guys. And we also decided to release the video interview with him early, because we wanted to push that project. So if you want to watch it, you can look at it at SteamWorld/interviews.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry, I should repeat that. SteamWorld.org/interviews. There is that interview with Dave Lowe. And another news is also that we decided to use the transcripts that we're using for the magazine as subtitles. So this means now people who have a hearing issue can even listen and watch to the interviews, the video interviews, because now they can read it as subtitles.
Okay.
And that's pretty cool, actually.
That is pretty cool.
Yeah. You know, we always try at SceneWorld to make things barrier-free, which is also why we have, you know, color switching option in the SceneWorld magazine. For the colorblind people, if you press C, you can switch between several color schemes that may look awful for people who don't, who are not colorblind. For those people who are colorblind, they really appreciate it. Yes, and well, what else? Yes, well, I can tell you about the Gamescom booth, because in the last podcast you asked me what we are going on the Gamescom booth, and what we will be doing is we will be partnering up with a group of people who are doing a video game music live to video games being played, you know, like replaying the music, like some kind of a live remix, you know? And so we will have SteamWorld, of course, running on several computers, and we will have a keyboard, and I even got from Frank Buss, I even got one donation of his recent MIDI model that he funded over Kickstarter. I just forgot its name, but let me see. Anyway, that's the Kerberos MIDI model, and so we will have live performances of SceneWorld magazine and those guys. And I will be wearing a t-shirt with Scan Me on the back.
Okay.
Just as we discussed.
Oh, good lord.
Scan Me, yeah. And SceneWorld on front, of course. You see? Yeah, here you go. So, look out for me.
Cool.
And our booth guys. So, that's very nice.
And you're going to be meeting with some of our previous guests. We'll be meeting Siren, previously of the Frag Dolls, as she will be there for Twitch. And he could possibly be meeting Charles Martinet, the voice of Mario, who we talked to
that's true.
last time.
If he will be invited, as he said, during the interview, but he mostly is. Mm-hmm. So I'm really looking forward to that. And of course, Sven Fössing from CinemaWare will be there also. So that's totally awesome. So I will meet those people, our former guests, in person.
Cool.
Yes. And as I just found out earlier in a phone call before this podcast recording, I will also be involved in a live Twitch show and for the German Film Museum in Frankfurt, starting in June and going till January of next year. And actually, I'm looking for, you know, like old game developers from Germany, or people who organized like demo parties. You know, like LAN parties in the past or something, in the 80s or 90s, and would like to talk about their experience, what they organized or what they created. And they could be a guest in the live Twitch show that is going to happen every last Wednesday in Frankfurt, and actually the whole exhibition. The whole exhibition will take place from June 1st to January next year. And as I said, in the last Wednesday evening Frankfurt, you could actually meeting me there as guest, live guest, if you have something to share and you want to share to a broader public and to the people outside of the scene, you know, and on a live Twitch show, let me know. So, if you want to be a guest, contact me or us. That would be at contact@sceneworld.org. And I'm sure we will put the details on our page
Yes, we will.
And other places. So you could actually meet a part of the SteamWorld crew. So two chances to meet SteamWorld in Frankfurt, be a live guest, or go to Gamescom and meet me there in the retro area.
And we also have some more things going on, such as, we're doing a video podcast here. This is the first time we're doing video. And we will be doing some more video-based things in the future as well. Jorg can tell you about that because this is his baby, kind of.
Well, I've reserved the URL twitch.tv/sceneworld. And so please subscribe to it and make sure you're enabled to be notified when we go online. I can't talk about it yet, but we have some really nice ideas, and we want to bring up something retro, of course, but something that a topic that wasn't touched yet in any Twitch live show. So, and again, our power of SteamWorld members and having good people in the team gives us the opportunity.
We have awesome members of our SteamWorld team. And definitely. we should throw out to an old member that is just coming back. We should, you know, mention Taco.
Taco yep. Hillenar. Yeah.
Yes, he is back with us now. He was one of the old guys from back in the day, and now he is back on full force. So we love to have him. And also, yep. I'd like to point out, because we have intro music that plays in the beginning of every episode of this podcast, and to date we have not given credit to the man who made that music,
Richard Bayless
made the music. He's another member of our staff. He's also a prolific game creator, so
yeah, he did Subhunter, which was very successful.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that's where our music comes from. And our webmaster, who puts everything together for us, Christian Lorenberg, he is an amazing. This guy goes well above and beyond. When we hand him awful audio files and we're like, make this a podcast, you know. I mean, he handles the web. He handles putting things to iTunes. He does all this incredible work for us. And it's really not fair to just to have the two of us sitting here talking to each other and not give credit to everybody else that is responsible for making this sort of thing a thing.
But that will change, because our first guest in the Twitch will be a team member of SteamWorld.
That's true.
Well, that will change. That's all I can say, but I don't want to spoil the surprise. We just have to find an appointment a day where to do the live show, but
let's do it tomorrow. No.
awesome preparing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that is actually the key thing about our team, is that we can really react on quick changes. You know, like, when would you like to do the interview? Like, how about now? Mm-hmm. Or like, you are recording this video. I'm like, no, you are making audio only. Well, you should, because we have dressed up. And so like, well, now we need a YouTube channel, because now we need to have sections of videos, which we have now, actually. So if you want to watch us on our YouTube channel, it's, well, unfortunately, the URL is kind of crappy, because actually, this year, Google and YouTube changed the way you can get the URL. But anyway, it's youtube.com/sceneworld.org/magazine, which is really awful. But I made a shortcut, and you can watch us also on our YouTube if you go to http. YouTube.SteamWorld.org. That's a lot easier.
Okay.
So awesome. We are on YouTube now too, and all our videos are there, and subtitles. and this video podcast too. So we are totally expanding to everything. And as I said,
and I want to be clear to our listeners that this is, we're doing a video podcast this time. This is probably not going to be the norm just because of the extra work it takes in order to put this together. I'm having to learn a whole new way of editing, and so we'll probably go back to audio with a couple of special video interviews every so often. But this is kind of a special thing that we're doing this once.
But I offered you to do the editing on the video instead. Mm-hmm. So you had my offer of help, and you said, no, you want to learn it yourself.
Yeah.
But anyway, still my offer there. Yeah, well, I know it's not so easy, but hey, we are two pretty guys, pretty guests.
Our guests are very pretty. I wouldn't go so far as to say we are, but
yeah, sexy Steve Boy podcast. Yeah. So, you see, a lot of things happened in the past 2 months. I mean, we have to take into account, we do this Steam World thing for 15 years now. No, 14 years. And this is so amazing. You know, I was 18 when we started.
Mm-hmm.
And how old you were?
Younger than I am today.
Great. So anyway... So anyway, we are wanting to make it the next 15 years too, so we can celebrate 30 years SceneVault.
Oh,
that's
God.
Actually my goal, at least. You know, AJ will be 50.
Yeah, you know? That's exactly. Yeah, in another 15 years, I don't know, 50. I'm not that. I don't think am I that old? I'll be older than I am today. I might be, 28. 29 by then. I'll almost be 30 by then. I mean...
Oh, jeez. You have a lot of fun recording that, you know? Yeah. Anyway. So, anyway, is to see, we have a lot of things planned. So, more than ever, now you have a chance to interact with us in person, live on Twitch. And I hope we get a lot of watchers on our first live show. And of course, if you missed that, you can see the recording afterwards, because I will put it up on our YouTube channel. So you can always, if you have the feeling you are missing us, you are missing our voices, you are missing our looks, then you can always watch us again over and over for the end of your life. So
have many nightmares.
Yeah. Yeah. So anyway, yes. So I'm very happy to know that we will be on Gamescom, and that we will be involved in a big event for video game exhibitions on Frankfurt. So that's totally awesome. I mean, I never thought that a hobby project that doesn't earn any money would grow so big, that we get so many opportunities.
It's really
and people
kind of
actually
amazing
want to
that...
be our guests and want to work for the magazine and want to do stuff with us. So hey,
it's really kind of amazing. You know, I still kind of have to sit back and pinch myself and be like, you know, we're talking to these people. Like, oof, dang.
How many podcasts have talked to Charles Martinet? I didn't hear of anybody.
Yeah, I don't know how many podcasts or interviews he's given, but just to be, you know, just to have kind of the privilege to sit back and talk to some of these people for an hour or 2 hours, however long it happens to go. You know, I mean, it's kind of cool to, you know, who thought that a Commodore 64 disc mag would lead us to this.
Well, I have to say it's just possible because of the team. I mean, we are 21 people, it's totally amazing from all over the world. And actually, I travel a lot to see those people in person. I mean, I even went to Lima, Peru to visit Victor. Mm-hmm. I went to AJ. I went to Andrew. So, yeah, anyway, you wanted to say how awesome it is to make a project that grows so big. Mm-hmm. That was your last
That's what
statement.
I was saying, yes.
And you have to still pinch yourself nowadays to believe it.
I don't know if I would pinch myself, just, you know.
You said that.
Oh, well, I just have to kind of sit back and just, you know, it's kind of surprising that, you know, such things occur. Well, I think we've talked enough. We have guests waiting.
Right.
So you're going to see suddenly Jörg and my outfits are going to change.
Of course, we went back in time.
Yes, because we recorded this on a different day than we actually recorded the intro here. So, yeah, momentarily we're going to warp through space, and then we'll be talking with your own Tell and Tess Fries of
exactly
Tess and Tell.
Who will actually, by the way, in 5 days from now, so probably when you hear this, have released Battle Willy.
So in 5 days on May 8th, which has probably passed by the time you're listening to this, they will have released Battle Valley. It's a remake of a C64 game music.
Yeah.
So that's pretty cool. Everyone should check that out. Well, let's get into it and let's talk to these guys because it's a really cool interview and it was really fun. So
all our guests were fun so far.
Yes, but these guys were also fun. So
fun.
Yes. So, ladies and gentlemen, it's Tess and Tell.
Yeah. Enjoy.
We're talking with Tess and Tell, Jerome Tell and Tess Fries. How are you? Welcome to the podcast.
We're good. Thank you. Thanks for having us.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
This is our
How
first. We're good. This is our first video podcast, so this is an interesting experiment. So.
Awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So, Jerome, you've been doing Commodore music forever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Since
you've...
the dawn of time, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
I made my first Commodore 64 video game soundtrack when I was 14 years old.
Oh.
That's like a long time ago now.
That is, yeah. Yeah. What game was that?
It was Hawkeye, actually.
Okay.
It was released in 1987. Mm-hmm. But I made the music in 1986-87. Yeah.
Okay, so you've been at this for quite a while, and I just realized I was going through some information, kind of trying to research up for this article, and you're one of those musicians where your music gets reused over and over and over again, you know. Mm-hmm. So I found out that one of your songs was actually in a demo that I had done back in
cool.
like 96 or something.
Nice.
So you've been. So you get around. You're one of the big names in the C64 scene.
Yeah. Well, and we'll just say demo music scene, so to speak.
Yeah. Demo music in general, because you're still doing that, right? You're still making music for games and demos.
Still attend to Commodore 64 meetings and stuff.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's pretty awesome. Yeah, it's like so cool that, you know, that scene is still active.
Yeah.
Right, and it's actually very hardcore active, you know. The people are still there, they will remain there forever, I think.
right, yeah. And Tess, now you are a musician, you're a singer.
Yeah, and dancer.
And dancer, yeah. With
yeah.
So, and how long have you been doing that?
Dancing or singing?
Either one, both.
singing. Actually, I started. I was singing since I was a kid. You know, mm-hmm. like eat something. I don't know. But actually, when I started, like really more, I would say professional. Mm-hmm. That's actually also when I was 14.
Okay.
And that's like the number I really. Kind of like imagine being the time when I really became kind of serious. So
both 14, that's interesting.
Yeah. So, yeah.
14 is
a long
good
time. Yeah.
And so right now you are working on making those styles together, mixing them up. That old retro gaming or, you know, video gaming thing, and that I think it's called Eurodance or something.
Oh, Pixel Pop.
Yeah, Pixel Pop,
actually. It's a mixture of, well, electro, 8-bit. We tried to throw in modern electric styles like dubstep too, but combining everything with her singing, especially, yeah, she's very good with high notes and everything. And it really matches the arpeggios and the 8-bit sounds very well. So try to combine all that, you know, into a mix that we call Pixel Pop.
Yeah. So it's basically, we were recording stuff, and I think maybe it was By the Sky, which is already released now and everything. Then I was thinking about the sound that I liked for the music. And I couldn't come up with a name. I was like, you know, a pixel sound. And then and, later, we just came up with Pixel Pop, basically. So
actually, you are generating a new genre for music this way.
Yeah, it's something old, something new. And it's like the best from the old, the best from the new.
Yeah. Really didn't want to exclude like stuff like dubstep, because I really adore that style when it's good, of course.
Yeah.
But not just going just dubstep or just chip music or just 8-bit or just electro or just techno or trance or something, but just
wild limits.
Make it like a big ball, big soup, and make very good dishes with it.
So it's all just a combination.
Yeah.
That's interesting, because there's been a lot of. And we've kind of talked about it here too, where there's been a lot of sampling and taking of the older C64 stuff and putting it into current music. And there was one a few years ago.
Rihanna.
Yes. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. And you know.
Timberland controversy.
Yeah. Yeah. So there's a lot of kind of that retro sort of thing is really in. And
it's just amazing that you hear these beeps and blobs everywhere. Seriously, not just in electro stuff, but also like rock and stuff.
Right.
Yeah,
which I find very interesting.
Yeah,
I mean, I can imagine it with electro and techno and all that, but you hear it in other styles too, like where you wouldn't expect it. So it's like it's become a niche, so to speak.
Right.
Which actually suggests why Pixel Pop is so kick-ass, because it's already out there. We're just like putting it together. So,
right.
Yeah.
Try to really focus on that sound, actually. Mm-hmm.
It's kind of also in regarding the computer itself as an instrument, you know, because for quite a few years, music that was made on a computer was not considered, you know, legit music.
That's one thing that always pissed me off so much, because, you know, when I was doing the Commodore 64 music and Game Boy music and stuff, I mean, I had three channels to work with, and I made it sound like music, you know, harmonies, melodies, drums, bass lines, everything, and really with structures like verses and choruses and everything. And people say, well, yeah, especially older people, like not the kids, they had to get used to that sound. But after the ringtone revolution, you know, people were getting used to this bleepy thing. Mm-hmm. They actually picked up on this sound. And I think really that also put 8-bit sounds, chip sounds a little bit more forward.
Right.
Well, I can remember that from my childhood when I was still living with my parents. My mom would say, could you please put the volume lower of that awful noise that your computer is making, you know? And I was thinking, no, mom, that's not awful noise. That's C64 music. It's real music. Look, listen to that. It's awesome. You can even hear the instruments, you know.
A lot of younger people had a passion for it, you know, especially Commodore 64 gamers and everything. And, you know, people would actually buy games just for the music. I did that for one of Rob Hubbard's Thing on the Spring. I actually bought for just the music.
Right. And And interesting is also that, what I wanted to say is, yes, that nowadays more and more people from back then, those composers, they are re-releasing their stuff as, well, you know, orchestra music or remixes, like you did with your Run 10.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And Chris Hosbeck is doing that too. And right now, as we talk, David Lowe, who is also called Uncle Art in the scene, is doing the same.
Okay, cool.
So it's totally the thing. But how did you actually get the idea of combining both? Was that something like, we want to create something new? Or well, what was that reason that you started, inventing?
The one thing was, whenever I showed Tess my music, she would actually instantly sing ideas on top of it, and I thought, like, whoa, this is a cool idea. With the music I made, you know, with the renoise and everything, very often I already used the arpeggios and stuff, the 8-bit sounds. Never stopped doing that. And, you know, when I actually went through the songs with her, she was like, whoa, hey, hang on, I can make a song of this, you know? And yeah, that's actually the one thing missing from my music. It's like, okay, I always wanted to have a really good singer right there and with exactly that voice. And it's really hard to get by, you know, just to get a good singer. And then, you know, finding her also being a dancer, loving 8-bit, by the way. I mean, she's like 23 years old. So for her to actually, you know, talk about games, Commodore 64 games, before she was even born, you know, and being into that, that's cool. I mean, how do you find a passion for that and someone with a great voice?
Mm. Oh, you.
Yeah, so it actually just happened, so to speak. But yeah. She had a kind of premonition that would happen, right?
Really?
Dun, dun, dun. Yeah, actually, it's actually true. I don't know how deep I should go into that, but it was like, I kind of knew that I was going to meet some musician that's, I had a premonition.
Okay.
Premonitions you can't explain, right?
Well, actually, I can explain, you know, another time.
Right. So so after By the Sky, which released in March, also on YouTube, what are your future plans after that?
You want to say it?
Well, yeah, right now we're working on... first of all, we're actually going to release Battle Valley. That's a C64 remake.
Yeah.
It's a game remake. Music remake. And that's going to be released... when was it? 8 May, I think.
8 of May. Yeah.
8 of May. And we're also working on a website. So we're going to have an official website coming up soon. And then we're going to... Yeah, we're working on a music video and a song. And you take it from here.
Yeah. About a Battle Valley thing that's going to be released on Tips and Tricks for Video Game Pioneers or something.
Yeah.
It's a very weird name for an album, but it's... So
pretty cool.
Remake album with Ben Douglas too, and there's actually three songs of mine on there, but one of them actually features Tess Fries. It's
okay.
From the Commodore 64 game Battle Valley, and I remade it into a 6 to 7 minute tune.
Yeah.
And yeah. And soon we'll release another tune and video. Mention the name or not?
Yeah, should we? Yeah, let's do that. Okay, no one has. Yeah. Okay, it's gonna be out soon. Yeah, come on, you know what?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's Spank Me Hard and Call Me Susan. That's the name.
Okay.
It's, that's actually, let just speak for itself. I'm kidding.
Okay.
No, but
it's of course a kind of a wink and a joke, you know.
Yeah, so actually,
it was fun.
You want to hear how it's how we came up with that song?
Yeah.
I think you actually, I think you said that to me when we were like cuddling or something. when we were, yeah, he said that to me, and I was like, you know, that's pretty good, and then we just took it.
It's catchy.
And then we made a song of it, and yeah.
Yeah, and in the future, record more songs, of course. Hopefully, at some point soon, start a Kickstarter project so we can actually fund recording music videos, because that's a costly business and a timely business, of course. So we can really focus on the music and the video full time instead of having to worry about rent and all that stuff, you know?
Yeah.
Right.
So those are our future plans, basically.
Yeah.
So you are actually working on the Kickstarter campaign. So you should definitely tell us when it's coming out, so we could black it. Yes,
definitely. Yeah?
And and you mentioned it. You also take part in that pledge reward for that. I don't know actually what it was called again. Video Game Pioneers book thing, mm-hmm. Right?
Not the book. It's Tips and Tricks. It's an album.
Yeah.
But they called it, weirdly enough, Tips and Tricks for Video Game Pioneers or something.
Tips.
It's such a weird name that I actually almost always say it wrong. But anyway, it's like.
Hints and.
Yeah, yeah, I know. Yeah, Hints and Tips for Video Game Pioneers.
Thank you.
I just looked it up because I pledged for it too, yeah.
You did, okay, cool.
Which is funny because Jeroen, the other day, he sent me those files, said like, look at this, and I was like, okay, I already have those because I'm a baker, you know? So how was actually the reaction of the community to your pixel pop thing?
They liked it. It's like, we actually got very positive feedback from the... you know, the 8-bit community, so to speak.
Yeah, and the synth scene, actually.
Yeah.
Which was quite surprising, because, I have, they're very picky sometimes. It feels like, but, you know, anyway, really good response.
They aired it on radio, so that's, that's nice.
Yes,
nice.
So it seems to be like future pop. People who like future pop, they like it, and synth music, like it goes in different styles, which is what we want to do, basically. We want to combine different styles and not just limit ourselves, but actually combine it to make our own thing on it.
Yeah. It's always like, that's with music, I always said that, like, it's really difficult to be put into one genre and then you're bound there, you know?
Yeah.
That's it. You just make that, you make that, you know? You make that.
Yeah.
And that's it. No, just, you want to, no, be,
you just do our
don't,
thing.
Don't want to be addressed in one thing. So one thing.
Because we can't.
Yeah, you can't call us electro, you can't call us pop, you can't call us
pixel.
You can't call us dubstep or something, you know? It's like a combination of that. So, I thought the best, we thought the best way to actually do it is to call it pixel pop, and then, you know, we can...
Then claim our music through that instead.
Yeah, instead of being, okay, you make dubstep, you're dubstep now, you know? Or you're electro, you're electro now.
Yeah, I never fit in any kind of style anyway, so it's like, yeah, well, you know, like, why follow trends when you can create them? So, yeah. Hiya!
So you actually generated pixel pop because you didn't want to be stuffed in a corner, and then you thought like, oh, let's do our own stuff.
I just realized that that is actually a very good reason. It's not the reason we did that, but that's a very good reason.
We're doing something, we're bringing something old with something new, and then, you know, mixing that into a combination of an old, new mix, retro, motherfucking modern shit, you know? Pixel pop. Yeah, you can censor that, but, you know, honest shit. So
that's an American broadcast. So.
Yeah, exactly. We don't censor.
Well, actually, Apple never censored our thing. That's right. Yeah, on iTunes, they always put up the full thing, so I guess we are fine.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah. So now just for a quarter, like, let's all just do like your motherfucking shit, motherfucking.
No. We were appropriate.
Yes.
Always appropriate.
Well,
so I'm interested in how the recording process works, because I've never done, you know, a scene music, nothing like that. I've edited some stuff in Voice Tracker, which is about the extent, and I look and there's numbers and I have no idea what I'm doing. But I have done, I used to be a drummer and I've done some in studio stuff. So I've got like a general idea of usually how the recording process would work for music. Now, when you do this, because it's not just C64 demo music that you're using. You're using different instruments and
yeah, VST instruments, all kinds of compressors and everything. But the right. main program I use at least is Renoise.
Okay.
I track all the music, and you know, with that, it's like most people use Cubase or Fruity Loops, or whatever. I use Renoise because I'm really used to programming all the music.
Mm-hmm.
I actually programmed all the Commodore 64 music, but I'd like to have control over every single detail of the note, and Renoise is a tracker is perfect for that.
Right.
He grew up on Harmony Street, so you know, he's a control freak.
Yeah, it was really nice to have full control. And
not kidding, by the way, he actually did. Yeah, he did grow up there. We have
I grew up on Harmony Street.
Yeah.
Okay. But when the music is it's not finished. I mean, when the music structure is there, within Renoise itself, you can actually record the vocals, which right. is awesome. It's actually, it's a little bit. Different way than you know you would do it in Cubase or something like a standard recording thing, but it works. Hmm. It works really well too. Like I can just take the part, for example, that she has to sing, and keep that looping for 50 times, and she can sing it 50 times. And
yeah, hopefully right. You know.
Yeah, and then
all the times I've done it wrong for like 50 times, yeah.
And then you can cut out the good stuff, you know. Right. Yeah. But it's really nice to work like that, in a way, because there's so much control that you have. You literally can control literally every little tiny 40,000.
Seven, two.
Yeah.
Hmm. Yeah, Nighthawks.
When the birds go to sleep, wake up, then we go to sleep.
Yeah, that's actually true. Always like that. First bird, and you're like, okay, shut up.
Okay, we're about... When the first birds start chirping and stuff, then start singing, then we know it's
like,
time to
good night, babe.
yeah.
Did we answer a question or did we go from a complete
that
new
was,
place?
No, that was a good answer. Yeah, that was exactly what I was asking because I'm used to.
About the birds and shit.
Well, no, well that's usually when you do your recording. Is it you know? I always did that night.
Yeah. When you're inspired.
Exactly, right, yeah. Which, yeah. Whenever that happens to be.
Yeah.
So now, do you make a whole, like, do you make a whole song with the 64 first and then kind of work around that? Or do you just make the sounds and, like, sequence them?
Exactly. Yeah, that's the Commodore 64 sounds will be, like, sampled
mm-hmm.
and used. That's the easy way to actually do it. There are Commodore 64 emulators and stuff, but you know, not really genuine, you know,
mm-hmm.
you can still hear it synthesized or something. They're pretty good ones, and there's also some, there's like a hard sit thing,
right?
That's a real, real sit. It's a sit chip, is the sound chip of Commodore 64 for those who don't know, and actually, the hard sit actually has that chip on the print itself, so you can actually use the real sit.
Hey, Jörg's got one of them.
Sorry, what?
No, I said Jörg's got one of them.
I've got it, yes, that's true.
Do you mean like how we do music together, or do you mean like how the Commodore 64 stuff is done?
Well, no, I basically
you
how...
If you first make it on the Commodore 64 and then go... On,
right, right, or if you just make the sounds and then sequence them in other
yes.
software.
Yes, exactly.
And are you a do you use an actual 64 to do the sounds or do you do it
well,
in an emulator?
Well, the hard sit is the device with real
because Jörg is kind of an audio snob for the 64. You know, he says if it's not on a SID, it doesn't sound right.
Yeah. You can hear it. You can hear that it's emulated. You know, mm-hmm. there's something really quirky about the SID chip. This is like a very old design from Bob Yannis, and he actually there's some bleed in the SITCHIP, which mm-hmm. means some of the circuits, they give off a certain electricity pulse, which makes it a very unique sound. Yeah, a very unique SID sound. And you can't emulate that almost. Mm. Actually, there's like a different version of the SITCHIP around. So every release sounds a little bit different too. So, But, you know, there's just multiple ways of doing it. But yeah, I'd like to use the original sounds.
All right.
It's better. It's more authentic.
Yes.
We should mention here, you even got rewarded. You got a reward in 1989 for Turbo Outrun being the best 8-bit video game sound in this year.
Yeah, and it was the only... Yeah.
Well, yeah, was
almost everything was 8-bit at the time, so that was a pretty cool reward.
Yeah.
Award.
Do you have more awards? Awards.
Yeah, but not for that.
No, still.
Well, I got none. I got no awards.
Yeah,
yeah.
Well, it's a good interview, you know?
Yeah.
Maybe you should send us an award sometime.
Yeah, I should get an interview award.
Yeah.
You should, because you're always you're very active in the scene, you know? You interview a lot of people, right?
That's true, yeah.
You have like a huge list,
yeah.
I think.
That's actually true. That's true. Yeah, more than we ever thought we would have, like Charles Martinet, the Mario voice guy we had the last time on the show.
That was pretty
impressive. Yeah.
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 Interesting thing is, I was looking at the stuff Tess was doing, and I realized you always use those, I don't know, finger extensions with the lights on the
light
top
fans.
Or something.
You mean her light fans?
You mean my light fans?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's going to be a big part, I guess, of our act too. A lot of light fans dancing. Need some fixing right now. But really cool stuff, seriously. Mm-hmm. I just love it. It's like so many different colors, so vibrant and...
LED lights.
Yeah.
For the world.
Mm-hmm. Futuristic.
Yeah, you could put someone's eye out with those things too.
Yeah, I know, right? Yeah. No, he gets it. Okay.
Self-defense weapon.
Yeah, exactly.
It's all for protection, guys. I'm kidding.
Yeah,
But it seems to be one of your key things, because I see a lot of videos you did, right? You like to use it a lot, actually.
Yeah, of course. I mean... it's really fucking beautiful. So yeah, I'm like a total fan of Tron, you know, and like Blade Runner, you know, like those visual styles that they have. It's like when I saw those movies, which by the way wasn't that long ago, then I was like, oh my god, like really fucking beautiful, like oh my god, like LEDs and light and
space.
So yeah, that's
sacred geometry.
Yeah, sacred geometry, like patterns, you know, like, and, you know, man, you know, like...
Computers, technology,
yeah.
Lights, LEDs, all that,
yeah.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Right.
That's the shit. Yeah. Yeah, I love that.
That's
like
also
that.
Kind of a big part of rave culture, too, I would imagine, you know, because there's a lot of light sticks and things like that, you know. And...
They took it. They stole it, bitches.
No.
No kidding. No. No, but yeah, it's true, actually. It's a big part there, too.
So. Yeah. Now I've seen Jerome use something similar when he's done some live stuff. I saw a video from Assembly. I don't remember what year it was, and you were doing a live performance, and you had the hand lights. I don't know what they're called.
Finger lights.
Yeah, yeah.
I think
yeah,
it was Assembly 2012 or something.
Was it?
2012, yeah. It's real end of 2012.
Hmm.
Mimic the melodies with my hand in the sky just to spice up the act a little instead of just mixing stuff on my laptop.
Right.
And yeah, I kind of think it looks really cool, especially with the VJ in the background, you know, the Seaman. Mm-hmm.
Love that name, by the way.
Yep. But it's a visual matchup, you know, to the pixel music thing.
Right.
I love lights too. It's like I really like the combination of having, you know, well, let's say pixelated music and pixelated graphics.
Yeah.
Right. It's just the match is like a really people really it's like a cult, it's like a cult in a way, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It's like kids they like it. I mean, look at Minecraft. It sold for, that company has been sold for 2.5 billion just because of a pixelated game called Minecraft.
Right.
It's the most popular game amongst children, you know, young children, and that's like this is where 8-bit becomes really popular again, you know.
Right. There's a lot of
there's a whole generation growing up with it now.
Right.
Many mediums for it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a lot of games that that kind of emulate that 8-bit style with the, you know, the pixelated characters and I mean, if you look at the, you know, like an app, the App Store for iPhones or for even the computers itself, it's there's half the games look like they were made on a Commodore 64.
Exactly. You know,
Flappy Bird, stuff like that.
Yeah. I'm actually doing I can't mention the title though because it's confidential, but I'm actually doing music for a game that actually features those pixel graphics.
Hmm. Cool.
So that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Always on fire.
Yeah.
But it's not on Kickstarter.
No, that is gonna be on Kickstarter, I think.
Oh, it's gonna be on Kickstarter.
No, that's not my thing. It's like not my project, but I do the audio.
Hmm. Ah, great. So another thing I have to bake or something.
Yeah.
Well, maybe. I can't mention it in public right now.
Of course, no problem. Well, it's interesting because if you look up on Kickstarter or something, those things are exploding with retro games and music CDs and orchestra and whatever. So I think with your new style, that pixel pop, you totally come in the right moment, you know.
Oh, yeah.
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 But why
do you say that? Like, why do you really think that? Is that because it's blossoming, basically, in the Kickstarter scene, or
no? Just the whole retro thing, the whole 8-bit thing, and pixels just
yes.
get really hot.
I mean, the last five years. I mean, we have mentioned it a couple of times in our podcast. Like almost every time in the last 5 years, at least here in Germany, everybody wants to relive the old times of the 80s and 90s. You know?
Yeah.
Oh hell yeah!
So it's kind of generating a memory, you know, or bringing those memory back. And I think this is what also makes it successful because people who were players back then, they remember parts of the music, even though it's something new. You reuse old stuff in a good way.
Well, retro is so in at this point, you know, everybody, there's all these, you know, reviewers online doing retro stuff, and there's these games that are looking retro, or companies that are re-releasing their games from years ago, you know, they're remastering or doing whatever to them. So there's this real kind of grasp towards this niche of retro stuff. So in that respect, you know, this fits perfectly because it's taking that retro, the sound and the music that is considered retro, but turning it into something completely new that can be consumed by a whole new group of people.
Yeah.
Masses. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's awesome. Do you recognize that retro thing in the visuals too, like in the music video, or is it the sound, or is it both, or
in the video for are you talking about your video?
Yeah, the music video.
Yeah, absolutely. There was parts of it where it felt like I was watching a demo. You know.
Yeah, cool. That's good.
Okay. I guess that's cool.
Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah.
Believe me.
Okay.
She's not from the demo scene, but
okay.
Well, she's getting there maybe in the long run. Who knows?
Yeah. Just don't show her any of mine because that will totally lower her expectations.
Yeah. Well, you are NTSC anyway. So
yeah. So I don't count. I don't count.
That's geek talk. I know.
Yeah. Yeah. He's too fast on his machine.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know.
To be even more geeky, yeah.
He heard all the Commodore 64 music at 60 hertz instead of 50.
I did, and you know, it messed me up because when I finally heard it through an emulator or through, like, you know, the high voltage SID collection, everything sounds too slow. Exactly. Yeah, I'm used to this being super fast, and now I'm listening to it, and it's like, come on, speed it up, let's go.
That's the world in my eyes, you know, or ears, or whatever, you know, ADHD, like, everything's slow. Seriously, that's why I kick ass at, was it tennis game we played? We played, we had a projector against the wall. Well, so we could, you know, we played, like, on an old machine thing.
Yeah.
And then I kicked everyone's ass on tennis.
It's like a Neo Geo machine. And it's like this Japanese tennis game. She kicked ass.
Yeah, because it's, you have to be so fucking fast.
Yeah.
So fast.
Couldn't keep up.
Yeah, wonderful. So if I understood this right, you are both doing your news thing, your pixel part, but you're also doing separated projects still.
Yeah, basically so.
So there will always be Tess stuff and Jeroen stuff and the thing together.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. I'd like to focus on the thing together, though.
Yeah.
And that really picks up then, you know, we can really focus on that, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But yeah, that's like, this is also where Kickstarter could come in really handy, that you can just focus on just doing that.
Yeah, I mean, imagine it's like any kind of relationship, okay. Imagine boyfriend, girlfriend, just for comparison or something. They can be together and they can be kick ass together, but you know, they should still have a fucking life, you know? Like, you can't just be one fucking unit. You have to have something for yourselves too. I mean, as long as you don't, yeah, you should bring something unique to it, both of you. Should have a life. So, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean,
music.
I think it's a very good thing to actually have your own thing too, so you can bring some inspiration to your
art.
If you're always doing stuff together, only the two of you, then the inspiration can run out easy, you know.
But it can also be a good way. For instance, when I'm doing something, I like working on the music video right now for like my Horn and Comb season. Then I actually need that time to do it, like to come up with new ideas. Like I really need to devote myself entirely to one thing, because then I'm draw like all kinds of powers to it. And you know, ADHD, I need to like really fucking focus on one thing. That works too. So yeah, a combination, I guess.
Yeah, and now, Tess does you do the videos for the music. That's your.
Yeah, mostly right now. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
No, I'm just asking because I think when you put two musicians together, totally different styles, like in your case, you know, generating something new, and you always have your fan crowd, you know. You have the fan crowd of Tess, you have the fan crowd of Jeroen, and then if you only do stuff together, it could happen that your fans say, well, I miss those old times, you know, those old styles, you know. What happened to Tess's old music style, you know? Why she's not doing it anymore? Or why is Jeroen not doing it anymore? That is why I ask this question, if you're still doing things separately.
Yeah, we are. I just received a song from Red Line, and that's like within the synth pop or electro more.
That's just you.
Yeah, that's just me. So it's but yeah, there's a combination that works. But I think the most important thing is that you also do something that you love. You know, you can't just like slave for others because, you know, like I actually like to say, put it this way, like I want to give people what they want, but I don't want to do what is expected of me. You know, like that's actually really important balance there.
Right, reinventing yourself every time.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah.
Well, especially not feeling too much driven to do something that you might not feel inspired for.
Yeah, not that box.
I know there's, some artists are just in it for the money and they will do whatever a producer says. Without asking questions or having any artistic input.
Yeah.
And basically slave for the producer. So just to get, the pop music out and get famous.
And you can hear that in recordings. It's like really commercial and you're like, oh, where's the feeling?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it can be kick-ass on that scene, but that's not what we're doing, at least.
I think it's also with all the computer music I wrote, I always kept focus on making it really good music, but really having my edge, you know, my own thing. Like most people say it, thank God, when it's ruined, you can always tell. It's like there's like a thing in my music that you can hear it's me.
Right.
What exactly that is, that's, I don't know, but it's there. I mean, I can hear it myself, and I also hear it when people copy it, which is also awesome when that happens.
That's really nice when you, like, if you have a musician that you really like, and you know that they have their sound. That's something I really like when it comes to musicians. It's original, it's something unique for them.
Mm-hmm. And also, like we do now, it's like there's a lot of input from me, a lot of input from her. A lot of fighting about it. That's part of the creative process, always, you know.
Yeah, you gotta fight.
I think if you don't fight a little during a project, then you know, it's good to have to fight to get the edges off, you know.
Yeah.
Right. Actually, yeah, it gets polished because of it in a way.
Mm-hmm.
First it's untangled, and then it becomes something of the two of you. Instead of me being dominant in the production or she being dominant in the production, it's like the best of both worlds then.
Yeah, you know, like how the air is like after a big storm, you know.
The air after a lightning storm, a thunderstorm. Everybody knows that air, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's when it's finished.
Mm-hmm.
Open for facilities.
Yeah.
but as I said, it's good if you see people are copying you, because then you think it's good because people like it. But in your case, as you now generated that pixel pop, you wouldn't like somebody to totally copy it, you know?
Yeah, I would. I mean, the best compliment is being copied. Seriously, I mean that.
Yeah, of course. I mean, that's the whole pixel thing, pixel pop. It's open for so many different things. So, yeah.
I mean, seriously, the best compliment you can get is being copied. That's the truth.
But there are also lawsuits, you know.
No, I'm not talking about copying the music per se, you know, not the music itself,
but
the style.
Use it.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. I mean, if they start copying your style, then you're on a good track, I think.
Yeah, use it for inspiration.
But not sample music like Nelly Furtado, Timbaland did, and then make a whole song of it.
Right.
Number one hit. And not paying the original composer, Glenn Ruin and Fossilos.
Mm-hmm.
Remember him?
Yep.
Yeah, we had a discussion about that case in our first podcast.
Okay, let's not go there. But I think it's like really weak of a really multi millionaire to actually steal something, say, well, it's just some game music or some Commodore blah blah computer music, and I made it into something big, where the whole song is actually nothing but those chords.
Right.
And a beat on top. That's all. And then, you know, they start singing on top of it. So that's plagiarism. Is that?
Yeah, plagiarism.
Yeah.
Plagiarism, yeah. But you know, but having the style copied, that's cool.
You actually could be a.
And I hope it will happen.
Yeah.
A lot.
You actually could be a beatboxer, I just realized.
I am.
He actually did that on the X, what's it called?
X 2014.
Yeah, he actually went up on the seat and started beatboxing, and everyone was like, yeah. Seriously, it's so fucking cool.
So beatboxing pixel pop, that's the next time coming up.
Yeah, maybe.
Well, that's one of my trades, beatboxing, but yeah, I haven't used it for pixel pop yet.
Could be a kick-ass intro, maybe.
But if you do, I want the credit for it, for the idea.
Oh yeah.
great. Yeah, so I don't know, AJ, do you have any questions left?
So no bra size, anything? No.
Okay. Bra size, oh.
His bra size or mine? I'm kidding. What about you guys, what's your bra size? I'm kidding.
I think I'm running an A cup.
Me too.
I guess shirtless recording is forbidden or something.
Is it?
I don't know. Better not to try. Not try finding out.
Take it off. Okay.
Yeah. It's just interesting talking about dresses because I'm seeing right now that actually Jeroen is wearing a Space Invaders t-shirt or something. Or is it
here?
Pac-Man or something? Pac-Man, no, I mean in the video. In the video.
Yeah, that's, those are the Pac-Man ghosts.
Yeah, Pac-Man ghosts.
Yeah.
Just realized that.
Yeah, awesome.
Hidden
yeah.
messages in the video.
Yeah.
That's
I mean, seriously, you can't get more iconic than Pac-Man, Space Invaders, well, of course, Pong, but...
Lemmings.
I wouldn't even say that that's not... It's
further with the real games, like Donkey Kong, Mario, you know, those are the real hardcore things that everybody knows. So even, you know, if you never played Pac-Man, you know what, even if you're 5 years old, you know who Pac-Man is.
Of course,
you know
Like
that.
My grandfather loved Lemmings, though. He
Wait, who is Lemmings?
No, Lemmings is a game with little creatures that... well, they build and they dig, and you give them commands to do stuff to actually guide them to the end of the level, without them dying too much. You start with I think 80 lemmings all the time, something like that.
100 actually 100.
It's a fun game. Seriously, that's one of my favorite games at the time. I really played it a lot.
And that is not because it was the last commercial game you did the music for, right?
On
the C64.
In 1994, actually.
Yes.
I think one of the last game releases on the Commodore 64 ever.
Professional release. The last one was Mayhem in Monsterland, actually.
Okay.
But it was the same year. It was the same
year.
Monsterland, that's cool.
It was Psygnosis who did it, actually.
That's awesome.
Exactly. Very good memory.
Yeah, well, I worked for them, so.
Wow.
I did the music for it, so.
Great. It's actually interesting because it's a game that was told to be not possible technically on the C64. So.
Really?
Yeah, because this only have 8 sprites, and to have 80 lemmings running around will be impossible. But somehow.
Nothing's impossible.
Well. Yeah, I agree. On the Commodore 64, nothing is impossible. I mean, there's always people who find tricks to do something that seems impossible. I mean, if you see the demos these days of Commodore 64, I'm like, mind blown.
And we have a really cool idea also about the LED thing. Well, there's a lot you can do visually with the Commodore 64 too.
Right.
You know, LEDs and all that.
Okay.
Ah. But in the possibilities. Yeah, like you said, you can do a lot. Yeah.
What about the outfit? I mean, I love that shirt with the with the Pac-Man ghosts.
That's interesting. Yeah. And actually the background you have right now in the video, it seems to be it from the video too?
No. Nope.
Or something? Nope.
No. It's the background for the video, that's all her work, but it's nothing. I think the backgrounds weren't filmed. No.
Wait, are we talking about music
video?
The
music video, yeah. But this background was not used in the music video. It looks like it, though.
It looks like, yeah.
It's Galaxy Stars.
Yeah, didn't we do it nicely? Put it off so well. Okay. No, but, yeah, that's different. Yeah. No, that's just, that's animation. In the,
CGI animation, I guess. Yeah. Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah, it was definitely qualities of demos that I saw in that was, you know, there was a spot where there were kind of vector things flying around, and it really kind of captured that. And even the beginning when it's just when it's her silhouette dancing, there's been a couple of demos where they've done something like that, and
yeah
it's very well done.
An Amiga that was this demo. It's just okay.
You mean Wildfire?
Because
that was converted to the C64 afterwards. Okay. Just a girl dancing, like a silhouette.
Oh, yeah. But anyway, the main point is that what AJ said, is like, there's been a lot of, there's been demos with silhouettes dancing, and that really kind of refers to that.
Seriously, in the music video. You really inspired me now. Actually, I have more scenes with silhouette stuff that I can totally edit. So like getting really inspired now. Bye guys, I'm just gonna edit some.
Okay. Yeah, yeah.
Okay, okay.
Getting really inspired.
So we are totally analyzing the video here. There are so many hidden messages, yes, details into that.
At second 45, in the second minute, there's frame 2000 of the video. There's a dot in the.
We have a true fan here. Okay.
Okay, she's been working on that music video for so many months and putting so much effort and detail into everything. It's like quite incredible. I wouldn't have the patience for that. I think it's like. Just for like 3 seconds of video, working for like 2-3 days on it, it's like kind of sick.
Yeah, it's actually true.
Yeah, but I like results.
Yeah.
So I guess in the future you want to release more, and you would also have to work on how often you want to release stuff. You know. That's also the key point. I mean, if you take so long on each video, that could be an issue.
That is an issue. But I think when she started working on the music video, she started learning a lot of other programs like After Effects and combining them with Premiere.
It takes some time in the beginning. I mean, once you get used to it and you find a workflow that works. God, now I sound like really fucking hardcore professional. Then again, well, the thing is, you find like you work with different things, and then you find something that works, and then it gets so much easier to next time. You know how to organize everything. You know, like once you've done it once, you know it doesn't take that long next time, and you know how to do it, like how to prepare everything and everything.
Still takes hard work though, but it's more in the flow of knowing what you do. Yeah, having in your head what you want to do and then getting it out there. I mean, that's the same thing for, I think, most art forms. It's like you have it in your head and now it has to be out there, you know, and that takes some kind of technique. You have to understand the technique. You have to and get that flow where what you have in your head is not distorted throughout using the techniques.
Yeah.
That's, I mean, seriously, that's always been a big deal.
And improvisation.
And I think that's for every artist, doesn't matter what it is. If it's painting or making music or playing a violin or making a music video or dancing, you have to.
I'm not limited by time at all. I would rather say if I want to be finished like at a certain time, I love to challenge myself. So, you know, just give me a date. I'm kidding. No, but that would not limit me. So it could just become better and better. So. You know, it's all good, man.
But we want to release faster.
Yeah.
That's for sure.
Right. So you have one track out that came out about a month ago, beginning of March. Actually, I guess that'll be almost 2 months ago.
Yeah.
And the next one, when is... Oh, I get to say this. When does that track drop?
Yeah, 8th of May.
8th of May, again.
Battle Valley.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, you announced it on your Facebook page, actually.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, now, you said Tessa's video editing the new music video.
Oh yeah, that was Spank Me Hard and Call Me Susan.
Spank Me Hard and Call Me Susan.
Yeah.
That's the one. So you're working on a music video for that right now.
Okay.
We released the song and the music video at the same time. Again.
Yeah,
like the other one. I think that's actually like most fun because otherwise the things are taking a context, I think.
Right.
Yeah, it's like kind of like a live performance. I mean, have a lot going on. It's better that way, I think.
So you're not looking to like do a release like a full album. Of music?
Yeah, we are.
Yeah, we are.
We're building it, but you know.
Yeah, we're working on, I think, on and off. I think about 8 to 9 tracks, which will be for an album. So that will be an album.
Okay.
But I really like the combination of video and music together right now, especially since we have the opportunity to do so.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, there are a lot of video DVDs with music on it. I mean, music video DVDs. You know?
Are there?
Yeah. I mean, I got one from Amazon Japan from the Sega sound team, you know? Because back in the 80s and 90s, the Sega had their own band, you know? And they had live recordings from their gigs.
Huh. I know that in Japan, you know, video game music hits the charts. That's the way it is.
Yeah,
that's actually true.
It's like video games in Japan are such a big part of their culture. It's just you can't even imagine it. Nothing. It's getting a bit of culture here too. Well, a bit of culture, a lot of culture, but there it's like it's woven into the whole culture.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And not young people, just everyone. Seriously, everyone.
And they have really sexy gifts, by the way, if you're into that, you know, animations.
Yeah, that's woven into their culture, too.
That's my kind of porn, man.
Okay. So you actually should move to Japan and make a gig there.
Hmm?
So you actually should go to Japan and make a gig there.
Oh, I performed in Tokyo, so yeah.
You did?
Yeah, I did. Okay. No, but I have a geek of geeks. Come on, you know. So yeah, I'm pretty cool.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. All set, man.
So now you have your new idea, making a music video DVD, not just an audio album.
That would be a good idea, but you know, making, let's say, 12 music videos, that will take a long time. That's not something you can just do, you know.
Yeah, so you have a point there that, yes, it takes time.
Then it takes, I think, too long, and it would take too long to actually do nothing but that, you know.
Right. Yeah, but it depends.
It has to be like releasing the music and then maybe later make video clips to them. That's like.
And that's why.
Music videos, that's a lot of work. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, a lot of fun. It's not like work to do it.
Yeah, okay,
but, you know, it takes a lot of time and stuff.
Yeah,
like
that's what I mean.
If you want to, like the way I do it at least, because it's so many details you want to write. You don't want to like compensate. What's the name? The word. You don't want to compromise.
Compromise.
Yeah, you don't want to compromise that.
Don't want to compromise quantity for quality.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's basically it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Quality is everything. Quantity is
something.
Well, it can be something, but if the you can't compromise your quality.
Right.
That means not every music that you will put on the DVD will have a video in the end result.
Hmm?
Well, you're actually talking about the DVD.
He's stuck on the DVD.
No. I mean, you are releasing an album, and since you said you want to make 8 tracks on it, but you can't make a video of them, right?
A full album will be like 12 tracks or something, 10 to 12. But we're actually working on 8 tracks right now. Like on and off, you know? There's like ideas for them,
yeah.
And we worked some really far out, and some are not so far out yet.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
But mostly focusing on the Spank My Heart and Call Me Susan thing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right now. And website.
Great, yeah. Well, hopefully hopefully this will be the next big thing on Facebook, now that you mentioned it as often. And this special title, I think people will love it.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
Great, great.
Yeah, so and the tracks are for sale. People can buy the track and download them.
Yeah.
Where can they get that?
Well, we originally released it on cdbaby.com, but it's also available because they publish it on, I think, everywhere.
It's Bandcamp, it's iTunes, it's Spotify. It's supposed to be on Rhapsody, but they made the mistake there. But anyway, you can buy it Bandcamp, and then you just go to our YouTube video and you can see the link. So.
Okay.
Yeah, if you just say Tazental, buy this guy, and in the description there's like where you can get it easy.
Yeah.
Okay.
You can also freely download it and stuff, but you know.
Yeah, okay.
But we don't want to do that. People want the high quality version that you know that is you have to pay for. So
of course.
Yeah. Support our rent, man.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, what is special about Jeroen especially is you are constantly cranking out something on SoundCloud. You're very active on SoundCloud, actually.
Well, not extremely active, but I try to release now and then because, you know, it's fun.
And he's good at it?
You need, you know, it's like a chicken has to lay his egg once in a while. Even if it's non-commercial, you know, just...
I heard that he's a chicken now.
Yeah.
No.
I'm always chicken. No.
Easton was over. Okay.
Yeah, but it's fun to release music that, you know, came from inspiration and...
Just, from his eggs?
Actually, we made this song 23 minutes long a couple of years ago. You've heard that, right?
Yeah, I did. Sure.
Yeah, but it's just fun to do. It's like, main extra noise thing. It's not like just not just commercial for games or something. It's like something that we're music collaboration group.
Yeah.
Demo scene group. Okay, that's what that
was. I mean, I'm totally happy that you are still active because. I'm talking to so many people who did, you know, video game related stuff in the 80s and 90s, and they stopped it after a while.
Okay, but they were also older when they started, you know.
Yeah, that's true. Different. That's true. That's
basically they died when they stopped.
No. I mean, Edward Powered is like retired, and Matbo is still active though. Don't know. I think he's more sound designing, but I don't know. I'm talking speculatively, but I don't even know. It's just like. Ben Douglas still does music. Who did retire? Well, Rob Hubbard, I don't know, but the rest?
For example, Dave Lowe retired from doing video game music because he said in 2008 companies started to want him to be there in person, you know, when he does the music, so they can watch him. And he said, no, I don't want that. I want to work from home. but nowadays the times are changing again thanks to Skype and video conferencing, which we are doing right now. So actually the wheel is turning backwards again because now people are going more from distances, and you know, so I think things are repeating in a way. Yeah. What would interest me is actually you have this Pixel Pop thing, and do you have a backup plan when this retro hype is going down? You know,
who said it's going to go down?
Who knows? Who knows? Yeah. I'm just asking.
All our trends, we create them. You know, exactly. That's what the Pixel Pop shit is all about. I never followed trends when it came to how we were supposed to wear something. I mean, look at me. Okay. No, but Seriously, oh my god. Okay, who the fuck cares? I really don't fucking care. I really don't. When it comes to trends and shit, seriously. I mean, the whole C64 scene, is that about the trend? Because it's hype? Because it's in? I don't think so.
No.
No, it's because we have passion. Yeah. That's what fucking matters.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Amen, system. So, yeah. Yeah.
All right,
basically, we wouldn't care about the trend or anything.
Right, and so many of the best... The most popular and enduring like music groups and individuals and whatnot are those that can redefine themselves and kind of, you know, not necessarily like you were saying before, you don't want to be pigeonholed into a specific genre or box, you know. It's like this is what you're doing, and it's not it doesn't have to, you can do different things. You're not stuck making the same exact thing over and over and over again.
Yeah. But I think what the Jörg said is actually interesting. This is something that I always try to do. Well, not try to, I always do automatically. It's like when I hear music which is new in sound or in the way it's done, in composition or melody or harmony or whatever, there will be millions of tunes always, but you know, just specific tunes will be really good, at least in what I like. When I first, I mean, I know where dubstep came from, drum and bass, but it's not drum and bass. It's like, when I first heard this, I don't know who pointed it out, someone said, like, you gotta hear this. And I was like, okay, this is so really fucking cool. I just dug up dubstep tunes for days and just listened, like, whoa, this is like something I gotta, yeah, you know? I gotta grasp it. I want to insert it into my style somewhere.
Or a system.
But not like just doing that. No, just have to insert it gently so it becomes
part of you.
A good blend. Yeah, yeah, part of me in a way. And you know, when there will be new trends. I mean, in 5 years' time, there will be some styles that we don't know yet. Hopefully, can co-invent them or whatever. You know, you never know where it comes from. But when it's good, you know, implement it. When it's that's how you do it. I mean, I think not a mistake artists make, because I understand they have a fan base and they expect something from the artist. So they talk like, okay, let's say the Stones. Okay, they made that type of music. They're pigeonholed into that, but they're huge in that, and I don't see them making dubstep. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It's like some styles are defined, and they actually define themselves as being that style. Yeah, that's the way. I'd like to adapt to whatever's trending. When I like it, only when I like it. I mean, there's some trends there. I won't mention them.
Basically, he follows my trends. Kidding.
There are some styles out there. Okay. I will not mention them because some people might get offended, but I hate them. I literally hate, I loathe them. But within that style, even within that style that I really hate, or some styles that I hate, even there's some good songs. Even there's always good songs, you know? I mean, there's like, you have a thrash metal band. Well, most of them I don't like, but I've heard thrash metal, which is bloody awesome.
It's not just black and white.
Yeah, it's not black and white.
Right. There's always good stuff, some bad stuff, some awesome stuff.
I think this is the worst thing you can do ever, you know, mm-hmm. when it comes to taste or something. Yeah, sometimes you have to eat something new I don't like that. So how do you know? Have you tasted it? Have you really listened to it? Have you really watched it? You know,
mm-hmm.
I think that's a very important thing for especially artists to reinvent themselves in a certain way. You can go to your path, your style, you know. Also, she doesn't follow trends.
Yeah, we
when I say
that.
When I say I love your fashion. What? Okay, you follow. You have this fashion. It's, no, that's not fashion. It's my style. And then you're right, because you don't follow trends in fashion or something. It's like you have your own style.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
He gets it.
And even if that's a little bit manga or something, then, you know, whatever.
Manga? Yeah, no, just graphics.
Yeah. Yeah, but you know, it's a pick out. I think that's it's easier said than done, because it sounds like cliche. Of course, I will adapt to new styles and good stuff, and I'll just pick it out and put it in. It's easier said than done, of course, but I.
Just go for what you like.
Yeah.
Totally different. Yeah.
Yeah, and don't stand still. Okay, now we're this, and this is gonna be us for the rest.
Don't limit yourself.
Mm-hmm.
So totally different question. Actually, I know that Jeroen has a brother who is also a music producer, right?
Composer/producer.
Mm. Yeah. In the Netherlands, right? So he's a producer and a composer or something?
Yeah, he composes and produces tracks for hundreds of artists.
It's really good. You have it in the blood.
So that is why I wanted to ask, how about you, Tess? Do you have music in your family? Do you have a sister or a brother who's also into music?
Well, okay, my mom's a nurse. So my dad's a doctor, so I'm probably gonna be a healer or something. Right now I just have ADHD now, so we'll see. No, but actually I'm doing cancer research too. But anyway, that's a hobby. But anyway,
hobby.
It's actually really interesting.
It's not a hobby, it's a
really awesome paper.
Mission.
Yeah, actually. Many different missions. Also building UFO, but we can get to that later. But anyway, so where were we? What did you ask?
Well, my question was if you have somebody in your family related to music.
What?
If you have
music.
Somebody in your family related to music, besides you.
Well, my dad is actually, my dad had a band when he was a teenager, I think. And He played in the band, and he has a really good singing voice. And he sang when I was a kid and played a lot of music, and really inspired me for that. Plays instrument, piano, guitar. My mom played guitar and stuff. Other than that, there are a lot of artistic stuff like photography and painting and but yeah, not so much more music, I think.
Yeah. No, but that's cool. I mean, there's a lot of visual stuff going on in your family too, you know, art, stuff like that.
Yeah.
Yep. With me, it's like, yeah. I never stood a chance.
He's like, his whole family, they're like all music.
Yeah, my father was a conductor, a piano teacher. My granddad actually played the piano at the silent movies. My great-granddad, whatever, was one of the first conductors of the first orchestras in the Netherlands. So it rolls all the way back to hundreds of years ago or something.
And again, grew up on Harmony Street.
And I grew up on Harmony Street.
Great.
Absolutely.
So all you need is kids now, and do follow that tradition, you know? Yeah,
exactly.
I'm kidding, yeah. Oh yeah, okay.
Yeah, it's cool.
Made up for kids already.
Hello. He made the first one, okay? Yeah. I just made the other two, okay? He's the one who's gonna, you know, give birth to them and all that, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's great. So actually, you are following a family tradition. Is like you said, you are growing up with the visual related family traditions, and Jeroen is having this piano thing in the background, in the past with his family. So it's totally amazing that there are two totally creative people. Persons coming together as a couple, it's totally amazing. It's totally inspiring for me. So that must be a perfect match, you know. Because if I try to do something creative, I totally suck in it, you know. So I better do interviews. That's the best thing I can do.
Aw, that's so nice.
Everyone's good at something.
You don't want to hear the names, the kid names? Hello?
No.
Oh, that sounds for another release.
And the website's not up yet, though. We're still working on that, right?
Yeah, it will be up like anytime soon. Actually, like it's almost there.
Oh,
so,
but
yeah.
But we could mention your Facebook, for example.
Yeah, the link is there.
Yeah, exactly.
It goes to Facebook right now, right?
Yeah, for those who actually wants to like see when it's like really up and finished and out there, which will be soon, then they can actually like it's just tests. And tell dot space actually.
Yep.
It's really fucking cool.
Space.
No, instead of com or anything, you actually write dot space. It actually works. That's like so cool.
That's and tell dot space. And tell is with one L.
Yeah,
space.
Exactly.
Yes.
Great.
So, yeah. And soon you will be redirected to the official website and not just Facebook, but you can check it from there. So yeah.
Tess and tell space.
Yeah.
I mean, I totally dig this. No, this new general domains, you know, that new generic top level domains. Because we got scene.world, and Facebook and Skype didn't even know it was a clickable address, you know, because it was so new, you know. So
that's nice.
Yeah, no. So it's perfect. So testandtell.space.
Yes.
Right. But you're also on Twitter, I guess, right?
Yeah. That's actually twitter.com/testandtell. So, yeah.
Great. Let's see. Yeah.
Slash URCBWSTW. I'm kidding. No, just testandtell.
Great. So, yeah. So that's your thing. That's really great. Well, from my side, it would be all. I don't know, AJ, do you have anything left in mind?
I think we're pretty good. I'm pretty happy with this.
Well, thanks, guys, for taking the time. A pleasure talking to you.
Thanks for having us.
I hope you enjoyed it as well.
Yeah.
It
was fun.
Oh, my God, no. I'm kidding. Yeah, it was awesome.
We gotta go.
Yeah.
Okay, guys. Well, from my side, I'm done.
Yep.
I guess we got it. And thanks again. and I wish you a good night. It's already 10 p.m. here.
Okay, then I wish you a good afternoon and you good evening.
Yep. Yeah, good night. Good night, actually.
Good night.
Yeah. Talk to you soon.
Okay,
yes, thanks. Indeed. Bye-bye, people. Bye.
All right, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Bye.
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 Whoa, sweet transition. Did you see that?
Yeah, nice. Good work, AJ.
It's like I have a whole suite of video toasters.
Great. Yeah, well, you're learning fast.
Yeah, yeah.
It's good.
Anyway, that was Test and Tell. You can find them. Check out their website at testandtell.space. Currently, that takes you to their Facebook page, but they will have a website there soon enough. You can also check them out at twitter.com/testandtell. And they have a Vimeo channel, too, at vimeo.com and Test and Tell. And search for them on YouTube, Test and Tell, or By the Sky, which is the song that they put out. They're on Bandcamp at testandtell.bandcamp.com, soundcloud.com/test-and-tell. You can also get their stuff at CD Baby at www.cdbaby.com/cd/testtell. And again, tell is one L. As for us, we have a new YouTube channel where you can actually watch this in video. If you've been listening to this in audio, then you've been missing out. So our YouTube channel is youtube.sceneworld.org, and then you can watch this in video and see the t-shirt that Jörg is wearing, which has changed from the other two sections of this podcast, which is pretty awesome.
Thank you. And, doing my best.
And you can find other things, podcasts, video interviews, articles, the disc mag itself at sceneworld.org.
And the interview that I did previously with Jeroen Tal in 2012 as well.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Jörg has a website. It's nafcom.eu. And
AJ has a blog at justmessofhell.com.
Yes. Thank you, sir.
You're welcome. Anytime.
Until next time, I'm AJ.
See you next time. Goodbye, guys.
Bye.